In this video, we'll look into one of the signature techniques of functional programming, currying. It's a short video, but to understand this currying, you need to know about functional programming and closures. For those who do not know these two concepts, I recommend you to watch these videos first. Currying is a coding method that allows you to break down tasks that used to be done at once into multiple steps. Let's imagine a function that makes sandwiches with bread, meat, and vegetables. The conventional way is that one function handles all these three ingredients at once to make a sandwich. For instance, when you enter each argument like this and execute it, a bagel bacon tomato sandwich is returned. If there are multiple choices for each ingredient, this single function would have to receive and handle all combinations of those ingredients. Currying divides this process for each ingredient, in other words, by argument. A function created with currying executes like this. As you can see, it gets executed individually as many times as the number of arguments the original function had. Like this, you can run it all at once, but this defeats the purpose of currying. You can execute the function in stages, as shown below. If you put a bagel as the first argument into the sandwich function, it creates a bagel sandwich function. If you put a croissant, it creates a croissant sandwich function. These return values are not the data to be used as final products, but another function. It's a new function to receive the rest of the ingredients. For bagel sandwich, you can put in bacon as the meat argument to make a bagel bacon sandwich function, or you can put in chicken to make a bagel chicken sandwich function. If you put in tomato as the final vegetable argument into the bagel bacon sandwich function, finally, the bagel bacon tomato sandwich you wanted is made. In this way, you can handle the existing process by diversifying it into multiple steps and branches. Now, let's review with the code. You can check the JavaScript examples to be used in the video on Notion page linked in the fixed comment. The names of the functions used in this example were named differently from the convention to help beginners understand. Let's first look at a function that has not been curried. Like this, it is a function that sequentially adds, multiplies, and subtracts four given parameters. As the name of the function indicates, it starts with A, adds B, multiplies by C, and subtracts D. If you run it on the console window of your browser, you can see that it returns 15 like this. If you write this function in a curried version, it will look like this. As you can see, function declarations are very complicated and verbose. If you declare it with an arrow function, it becomes more succinct. However, unless you've used a functional programming language, it's hard to know at a glance what the code is doing. When you're doing the practice, you can declare only one of these two versions of the function. Now, let's run the code that calls these functions with numbers. To run this function all the way through, you just need to call it like this. As you can see, we sequentially put in four arguments one by one, which resulted in the return of 15. Let's take a closer look step by step by putting in the first argument like this, and then as a result, the inner function gets returned like this. The returned inner function now has the number 2 in place for variable A. So, if you sequentially input the remaining three arguments into this function and run it, you will also get a return of 15. The fact that a function can return a function is because functions are first-class objects in this language. The reason the returned function remembers the argument value of the higher function is because the principle of closure is applied. Now, let's put another argument into that function and run it again. These two are codes doing the same thing. One is the result of putting 2 and 3 into the initial function in sequence. The other one is the result of putting 3 into the result of the function that just put 2 in. That is, they are both the results of putting 2 and 3 in sequence. So this time, such a function is returned. Like this, you can run it twice more with arguments to get the same result. The last two are also the same code. You're getting the hang of it now, aren't you? Because it was executed 3 times with these arguments, this function is finally returned as a result. And you can achieve this result by inserting the argument 5 into that function.
It looks like a really fancy code, but I don't have a clue where to use this.
Let's take a look at an example of a function that prints logs depending on the type and message given. This function takes a prefix and a message as arguments in sequence and prints the log in this format. As this is a curried function, you can create functions by prefix so that you don't have to enter a prefix each time. When you run it with a prefix as an argument, it returns a function that takes a message and prints out the log. The infolog function prints a log prefixed with info and the error log function prints a log prefixed with error. In this way, we can easily create variations of functions to suit our needs. You can certainly write the same functionality without currying, but it lacks conciseness and intuitiveness. The difference will grow as the number and each branch of parameters increase. Shall we take a look at the code that sends an AJAX request to a given URI this time? Like this, currying is done in three steps: the base URL, endpoint, and parameters. To send a request about a specific online shop, create a function with the base URL value fixed by inputting the address of the API as the first argument. Then, depending on which dataset you want to send a request to, create individual functions with the endpoints as arguments. When these functions are executed with the parameter values as arguments, the request is sent. Like this, by utilizing currying, you can increase the reusability of codes and enable more flexible programming. However, if you overuse it in the field, it may cause confusion for colleagues who are not familiar with such codes.
I might be a nuisance by coding only I can understand.
Yes, take this into account, and with appropriate use of currying, you can write codes that better utilize the strengths of functional programming. In the next video, we will finally look at the most challenging topic in functional programming, Monad. I'll see you in the next video then.